Thanks, everyone, and thanks for sticking around for the last talk of the session. I think this will be fitting. It's going to be a pretty casual talk with some photos. I wanted to say that I think the original intent of this talk was really to open a dialogue and really get some feedback from everyone. And I know it's a little more difficult now, but I do encourage anyone, if they have any questions or any suggestions, to track me down, and I'd like to pick everyone's brains. I think the main focus of this title slide right here is the low density. So not only is it difficult to monitor these individuals, but it's difficult to track them and to confirm their presence. And so this is overall a large scale project with heaps of questions throughout New Zealand of predator free, and certainly in Taranaki itself. And so we have a lot of people involved in every capacity, especially this mustelid work. So thanks to everyone. So what we're trying to do, so in Taranaki, in the North Island of New Zealand, there's a major push for predator free, especially introduced mustelids, which we have stoats, we have ferrets, and we have weasels, which is a smaller weasel than a stoat. And one of the main questions is managing the reinvasion risk posed by these mustelids. For example, moving from the ring plain into the national park, and that's that dark green on the right. And so there's a major management focus for eradication within that, but there's concerns about reinvasion from outside, and all that ring plain area is mostly farmland. We do want to understand how each of the mustelid species uses and disperses across that ring plain into or out of the national park, but especially the stoats. There's key concerns for dispersals. They can disperse long distances. And also specifically to collect data to aid in the calibration and population of these animal movement and habitat use models that other members of the team are working on. And that photo on the bottom left is a stoat with a collar on it, and the one on the right is a ferret. And so what we mean by the ring plain, it's hard to see on that image on the left, but in the middle, the brown area, this is Taranaki Maunga Project, that's the national park. And that zone two, that green area around, is what we're calling the ring plain. So all those different zones are different predator-free management focus zones for different time frames and different species. But number two is specifically farmland with a focus on mustelids. So what we're doing is we are live trapping these individuals. These are sort of classic lever traps, or in New Zealand sometimes they're called holden traps. We're baiting with fresh rabbit or lightly salted rabbit, so the bait can last a little bit longer. But the rabbit seems to work well. We have experimented with some mustelid, some ferret lures that some of our members, including Patrick Garvey at Landcare, are working on. And that has helped. But in this sort of quote unquote low densities, it's been difficult to get enough individuals to collar and to track for this study. And initially, we were VHF radio collaring, GPS collars for these stoats. The technology hasn't quite caught up, and so we're having difficulty getting GPS collars to fit. We do have some for ferrets, but traditionally, VHF collars have worked pretty well, and so that's a pretty standard procedure for us. We have to avoid anything with antennas. These stoats can basically bend all the way around into a U shape, and they will attack those collars. They'll spend all night. Well, we also experimented with GPS tags, and these are actually made for birds. And so we do have a little bit of data from this, but ultimately this device did not seem to work well for stoats. What we do, we would shave the fur and we would glue them on with a little bit of neoprene, kind of like a wetsuit material. And then we made a collar out of a zip tie, but there's a breakaway that'll, over time, the thread will break away just in case. And we will show a few results from these. And then again, the classic VHF telemetry was on the ground, and major difficulties with collecting this data. So if we did get collared individuals, we had a lot of times difficult finding them, sometimes ever again, and certainly getting consistent data, not even daily data. And on that photo on the bottom, if you can see, so that's the manga, that's Taranaki, Mount Taranaki in the back. But it's all these hills. It's very hilly. It's a lot of obstructions. You can rarely find lines of sight. So ultimately, we did end up using some fixed-wing aircrafts to get some telemetry data, but that was inconsistent and it was costly. And regarding the GPS tag, we also still needed to find the individual to download that. If we had retracked the individual, we could download it. But in the meantime, if we can get close, you can download that GPS data via the VHF signal. But again, we had difficulty relocating any collared animals. Here's a little bit of data from the VHF collars. This is kind of a busy graph, so excuse me, but we had four individuals that we got some data in, and really only two of them consistently, the blue and the yellow. And most of the on the ground, I didn't even include all of them, were in the same areas that we had caught them. So this was a little later than some of the dispersal individuals. We would hope to get some juveniles that were large enough that we could collar, but that had still not begun dispersing. And it looks like at least it's the blue and the yellow one were established in that area. We never found the brown ever again and only found the green once, so it's possible. And then they were older juveniles, young adults, so it's possible they were dispersed. We didn't find them again. And ultimately, those larger ovals that you're seeing, those are fixes from our fixed-wing aircraft, and we ended up just trying to get once a month. And the positions that we did find, it was all within 3 kilometers. So that is interesting to know. But the degree of resolution really varied with the fixed wing, as well as it was too much effort, too costly. So we ended up only getting once a month. This was quite interesting. So we ended up GPS tagging two of our individuals. One of them we re-caught the next day and the tag had already begun to rip off. And so we removed it, the tag completely. And it's just, I think that since these stoats can, like I said, can bend around in almost a U-shape, but they can grab something that's the slightest amount that's sticking off the end of their neck or anything. And I think it just spent all night sort of ripping that off. But we did get one that was collared, or that was tagged, excuse me, for about 10 days. And that top image, it's the same image, it's just zoomed out. And on the right, at the very top corner, you can see the beginning of the national park of the manga, so all the forest. And then everything else is that real patchy farmland with some forest and some waterways and rivers along the way. And what we found was that the individual used really patchy, dense vegetation and revisited a lot of these sites. So we had it set on hourly. And I don't have it color-coded correctly, so we do have some gaps in this data. We even have an entire day. We had 28 hours of gaps. And it was really bad weather then. So you're going to in anything like this, if we ever get the right kind of GPS collar or tag to work on the stoats, we're still going to have difficulties with loss of data for GPS signal. But this right here was quite valuable for us on even a few days, but getting some of that fine scale data and understanding what they're doing really motivates us to find a GPS solution for these individuals. And we noticed that they were active in 24 hours, in the day and the night, certainly in the morning and the evenings, but sometimes in the middle of the day and sometimes in the middle of the night. And that's really good to know. Sometimes stoats can be traditionally very nocturnal, but if there's a high density and high abundance and presence generally of ferrets, often they can be pushed to be more diurnal. And we were noticing at least this one individual was active multiple times a day. But we are expanding and we are trying some potential additional methods. And I didn't touch on, we are also trying to get the VHF signals, so get our fixes via a UAV, and we're trying some of that as well. But it's still on the latter end. It's still trying to actively collect that data, and especially with the terrain, we're having difficulty. So one of the methods that we're hoping to look into, and we had hoped to have some data, but we had some COVID complications, including with our colleagues at International Wildlife Services in Europe, and one of them even contracted COVID, but he's okay now. So we're having we're a little delayed on that. But what we're hoping to use is utilize the LoRa network, LoRa long range. So the LoRa WAN long range wide area network. It's one of the main low power wide area networks that's used for the internet. It's currently active in the Taranaki region with 17 gateways. And what it's right now being used for is that bottom left photo is a trap. It's a smart trap, an eco node trap. So what it does, it sends a binary, a yes or no signal to a tower that's sent to a cell phone signal that can go right to your computer or right to your phone to say that trap is tripped. And then they have an entire network out there, and so they don't have to check them every day. It's pretty simple. But with the LoRa technology, what they can do is they can also send small amounts of data. So you can send GPS data in a CVS file, CSV file, excuse me. And it's not a new concept, but it's quite difficult to get these collars small enough to what we need. So we're working with this group that kind of is a smaller group that's been specializing in some very small collars. We're only starting off with ferrets. We're getting our collars the sort of 5% body roll, and we're often getting females at 700 grams. They're getting us collars down to 35 grams with GPS and the LoRa piggyback. And so that's really exciting for us. And we're hoping to get some collars in maybe even next month. And so we're going to deploy those around and see what we get. And the next slide, this is just an example. We sent a test device. It wasn't in collar form. And we just put it in an ice cream tin. And we drove around on a side-by-side while we were doing the trapping for the VHF. And so all these blue dots are GPS points. You can notice they're just on roads right now because that's what we were driving on. And this image is actually from just a screenshot of my phone that's been cropped because they created a Wii app for that. And what it is, again, it's completely passive. So once we've collared the animal and we've released it, then any GPS points it can get is stored. And then whenever it's in, not whenever it's in range, and it'll check once an hour. And you can change what the programming is, but we're quite limited on space and battery power. So we want it to check once an hour. If it's in range of a LoRa gateway or tower, it will then just automatically upload that data. So again, it's not necessarily new technology, but I think for our specific uses in Taranaki and on these Mustela individuals, we're really excited about the potential, what this can give us. We can focus all our effort on trapping and collaring and all on the front end. And hopefully this data could just be sent to your phone while you're working in the office or out at the pub or anything like that. So we'll keep you updated on that for sure. So check in. And then real briefly, I can't tell how I'm doing on time, but this is my final slide. We have some other alternate methods as well. And one is molecular focused, led by Dr. Andrew Veal. And what we're doing, and this is even slightly outdated, we have more, but we have been collecting tissue samples throughout the entire area. And so the red dots are stoats. Those are the majority. So we have at least, I think, 160 stoats so far, and they've all been analyzed. They've all been extracted, excuse me, and they're currently being worked on sequencing. And what he's trying to do is it's just another way to understand overall large scale movement throughout the landscapes. We really are relying on some of that fine scale data. But general movements is still very important to the sort of long-term concern of movement and reinvasion back into that. And so what he calls is trying to create a friction surface to sort of predict movement, at least based on what has happened before and what's currently existing. And I think that was it. So I don't know if we have extra time for questions, but please track me down. And I welcome all the tech gurus who have any thoughts on GPS collars and devices, especially on smaller animals. Thank you.